It was designed, well, this is the body of flesh. There's just so much here I can't go into, but you have to feed this thing. I mean, God is going to, in a way that will keep it healthy and strong, like a machine and moving forward, and you can do your work, what you've been called to do, okay? Disease is not from God. Cancers are not from God. Something's going awry in the molecular structures of our bodies. What is it? It's called GMOs. There's many ways in which they can do this. They, the enemy, and unpack that one. But I am telling you right now, this is a battle. I mean, come on, if you want to fight, win this one. Get them to start putting GMO labeling on food, and so you can have a heads up about this. I mean, people who are living on Walmart shelves product, you are going to get cancer. There's just no getting around it. That's what it's designed to do to our bodies. Now, I'm saying, because it's very personal to me. It's hit my personal home and my family. You have to be ever vigilant. The enemy is a roaring lion seeking who he can devour. Israel was given dietary laws, not because God didn't want to eat popcorn or whatever. I mean, there is deep stuff going on here, people. All right? So if they can genetically modify food that can cause us diseases and cancers, do you think that they can genetically modify more sophisticated things? Okay? I mean, this is what's really funny to me. I mean, just watch TV. Just watch the commercials of the coming shows and some of these shows. This is my thing. You think this is all made up? You think that the enemy, he's just strutting his stuff in front of people, intimidating. He's got vampires out there. He's got Superman. He's got all these, the most devilish one. This show called Resurrection I just saw. I mean, how devilish to play on the appearance pain of losing a child. I mean, I'm talking about lying signs and wonders in front of your face on TV, what they're showing you, that they're, it's just, we have to wake up, people. This one, you have to wake up, because this is not a game. Now, this is what's coming down. Because of this genetic infiltration, and it happened in the garden, in the DNA of man. This is our problem, people. Our DNA has been infiltrated by the enemy. I can't say it more plain and simple, okay? If you understand Genesis 6, when those watcher angels came down and they cohabitated with the daughters of men, again, complete genetic manipulation into the DNA code. So this is something, when Paul says, for out of the heart are the issues of life, your DNA is your heart. You will respond evil out of the, you know, because you are just, you're replicating. See, remember what I said. This is very key. If you want to keep it on a purely scientific level, you will replicate the codes that have been introduced into you, okay? So in other words, that this genetic infiltration, it becomes a part of you and it will replicate. So in other words, if your eye is not seeing, you know, full of evil and you are immersing yourself in evil, you're thinking it is going to manifest into your actions sooner or later. It has to. This is how things grow, you know. A seed gets planted and then eventually, boom, a fruit comes out. These are absolute laws of physics. They work on every single level. And if your body can get sick from you know, genetically modified foods, let me tell you what, your soul can get sick, okay? What do you think demon possession is? I mean, come on, people, we have to stop being like little children about this stuff. You need to grow up and get some meat here. Now, let's just go into the war scroll, because I think I have had enough ranting about all this, probably. You know, because one of the things is, all right, I do have to say one last thing, because listen, we just got to get a little up on who's who. In the sense that Jesus said, and he said, you will know them by their fruit, okay? So, you know what? Yes, the world is populated by some very strange creatures, okay? How do you know? Jesus said, you'll know them by their fruit. Listen, this is what he's saying. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. It's not rocket science. You will know them by their actions. People who love peace and goodness and mercy and kindness and justice and plenty from everyone. What kind of fruit is that? I mean, that's the fruit of my Father. That's who our God, who is love. I mean, he has a personality. If you're going to replicate his DNA, you're going to have the fruits of the Spirit. Goodness, meekness, patience, long-suffering. You're going to not, you know, do despite for your neighbor. You're not going to defraud your brother. You're not going to steal. You're not going to kill. You're not going to murder. You're not going to lie. You're not going to covet. You're not going to commit adultery. I mean, not that we don't do these things, you know, in the sense, but you're just, this is, okay, then the flip side. If you are full of murderers and adulteries and thefts and fornications and sorceries and witchcrafts and homosexual acts, I mean, what can I tell you? Look at the fruit. And money is a key, you know, the love of money. You know, we're not in this world to, I'm sorry, we are not in this world. It is not our best life now. Hello, people. That is smooth words. That's what trip is. You know, that is what is called a smooth things. You know, just tell people what they want to hear. Oh, it sounds really great. Man, I can have my best life now. I don't have to worry about the future. No. Okay. One of the books that came back to us that I believe, and its scholars will attest, this is one of the oldest. They think this is one of the most early extant manuscripts, the Didache, okay? Now, I happen to think that this was what came out of the council in Jerusalem, okay? And this is a whole story. You have to really know your people groups. I said you got to understand the scenes. You got to understand the early church. You got to understand the leadership with James, the Lord's brother, and Jude in Jerusalem, and the 3,000 that were saved right out of the Essene group right then and there. You know, when you really read it from an Essene book, you really understand a lot of in the book, what they're talking about, having all things common, you know, all this kind of stuff. This is Essene typology. This is Essene lifestyle. A lot of it comes out of, this understanding. But I believe that the Didache was the work when they all of a sudden saw that the Gentiles were being allowed to come into this covenant, to this relationship with Yahweh now, and they were manifesting, you know, speaking in tongues and a lot of these spiritual giftings, it kind of was like a whole new curveball. And a lot of people, they weren't prepared for this in some respects. I think Paul really got it. I think Paul understood this season and that God was going after the Melo Hagoyim, the fullness of the Gentiles now, the lost sheep of the house of Israel, Yasi that had gone off over the whole earth. But they were beginning, it was a very, and we're at the same place today, I'll tell you what, the two houses are coming together. What do we do with the law? What do we do with the feast? I mean, this is exactly a dialogue we're having again today. But this time I think we're going to end it right. We're going to get it right. So I think the Didache was a work that was written to all these new Gentile believers who were not coming in to practice the law, because something you have to understand here, the temple was destroyed in 70 AD and there were prophecies that had gone out, and to the elect and to the righteous people who are listening, who are believing this thing, who saw Jesus, you know, die and get resurrected, they believe these prophecies, so they got out of Jerusalem, okay? This 30 years, a lot was happening at this time. So they were out of Jerusalem. It was kind of evident to everybody, well, we just can't keep this temple thing going on because this is not obviously can be the model. But you have to be careful here because it got hijacked so far. Trying to get back is like, oh my gosh, it's like wading upstream in a torrent coming at you. But, so what I just want to say, they say the Didache was one of the first within the first 40 years after Jesus. So that would put it in the time frame, okay? And so I believe that if you read this thing, the standards for holiness are so high, the bar is so high, if they had kept to this, if we had kept to this, if Western Christianity would just pick up this document and read it and do a checkup from the neck up and go, oh my gosh, I am so far below the standard. Maybe we could have revival in the house of God. But anyways, one of the things is about false prophets. You have to understand there really is a litmus test, and it is a person's lifestyle, okay? And if you study out the prophets like Isaiah and all these guys, and this is what he said about John the Baptist. He said, what, you thought you were going to go see a prophet, one of my prophets in the palaces? You know, eating all the dainty food? No, and Jesus, like, no, that's not where my prophets hang out, let me tell you right now. No, this world is not our home. The whole issue with, it's a story with Elijah and his servant who took a bribe. He took all the gifts and things that were offered to Elijah for something Elijah did. And the servant, it was just too good to pass up. So he went running after the guy and was like, hey, I'll take it. You know, give it all to me. And, you know, Elijah got wind of it. And he was like, you know, you don't understand at all. This present life is not the life for our rewards. We do not hoard up treasures or riches on this earth. We get our daily bread. We're to work to provide for our daily bread. There are standards. But if you're out there still chasing the almighty dollar and your best life now, you are absolutely clueless to the true gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, it says that not everyone, now let the apostle when departing, see they had rules, and I won't call them rules and regulations, they had deep understandings of how to protect the sheep from, because even Paul said, listen, they're going to come in, Jude said it, you know, evil men are going to come in unawares, and they are going to infiltrate. They knew this, but they tried the best they could to protect the people, to protect the flocks, to protect the truth. Now, and let the apostle, when departing, take nothing but bread until he arrives at his resting place. See, we're not supposed to make money off the gospel. Everything, I just give for free. What do I care? I mean, God feeds me. I feed you. Whatever. I shouldn't say this, but you know, I work in a Christian bookstore. I work in the level to which the Christian publishing has sold out to the world is pretty quite remarkable. But do you know that if I told you some of the advances some of these people get, some of the money, some of the unbelievable wealth amassed by some of the, you're like, there's something not right here. I thought Paul said that, you know, not that we're all supposed to have this commonality amongst ourselves so that not some would not be overindulged and some would constantly have want and need. We're supposed to be, you know, kind of taking care of each other in this thing together, okay? When it says here in, but not everyone who speaketh in the Spirit is a prophet, but he who is so, who hath the disposition of the Lord, by their dispositions they shall therefore be known, the false prophet and the true. And I will tell you, I have three different translations of it here because you have to read in different translations because I can't really get back to the Greek or Hebrew in these. I haven't found a text online, but or the Greek. But he says this is better. And every prophet who speaks with the Spirit, you will not test or judge. For every sin will be, well, let me start here. But not everyone who speaks with the Spirit is a prophet. But if he has the conduct of the Lord, therefore from their conduct, the false prophet and the prophet will be made known. And no prophet with the Spirit who orders a meal eats from it, unless indeed he is a false prophet. Now I wish I could unpack that because eats a meal, that's a whole kind of code understanding. Eats a meal, I'm serving you up a meal, okay? And eats from it. In other words, I'm giving this to you, so I mean, I think I can get the next book deal and you know, sell a ton of books and be really, you know, and have my 15 minutes of fame and you know, be glorious and on all the talk shows. And do you know what I'm saying? No, and no, and no. Okay? If he does not do as he teaches, he is a false prophet. Now, every prophet who teaches the truth, if he does not do as he teaches, is a false prophet. But every prophet who has been proved, who is true, who does things for the cosmic secrets of the assembly, but who does not teach as he does, will be. For ancient prophets did it this way. But whoever says with the Spirit, give me money or something else, you will not listen to him. For if he says to give on behalf of others who are in need, that's a different story. No one should judge him. Paul took up an offering for the saints in Jerusalem. Now, let me read that again in here. Every prophet who teaches the truth, if he does, if if he do not what he teaches is a false prophet. But whoever shall say in the spirit, give me money or things of that kind, listen not to him. But if he tell you concerning others that are in need, that you should give unto them, let no one judge him. Okay? Let everyone that cometh in the name of the Lord be received. But afterwards you shall examine him and know his character, for ye have knowledge both of good and evil. This is the whole point. We're to discern between good and evil. They did let prophets speak in the assembly, but they would discern. You have to know a person's character. That's why Paul said we are to know them who labor among us. And I say that in our local area, you have to know people. You have to see their fruit. You have to judge their character. There are some wild stories about some of these people out there. And because of the infiltrators and the Luciferians, I mean, it is crazy. You have to be able to judge the fruit of people. Now it says, if the person who cometh, if you would just read this, you would sort of get some of the understanding of what Paul was coming to. While Paul went to a city and he was a tent maker. You know, you are supposed to work for your daily bread. We are not supposed to live off of the gospel. But if he not be willing to do so, he is a trafficker in Christ. From such keep aloof. So I just have to say, there are ways, there are tests. You have got to start to be discerning about the people, and you have to know the character of the people from whom you're receiving knowledge. Now, that all being said, there's more to that. But anyways, let's get back to the war rule. This is the opening. This is the first couple chapters in this book, all right? Because I have to tell you, now I have to tell you what we're up against, okay? Because, let me tell you what, with this genetic man, Satan has been working overtime, making his hordes of heaven, okay? Hordes of hell, okay? And he's coming at us front and center. Jesus said that this would be the greatest time of stress that the world had ever known in Matthew 24, and that had not been known before and would not be known again. And except for the elect, he was going to cut, you know, for the sake of the elect, he was going to cut the time short, okay? So, this is what you have to understand. Because, see, this time, Satan is coming at us, starting with the abomination of desolations, and the veil is getting very thin, and he is going to come at us with both barrels blazing. And he's going to have all his hordes of hell, okay? And I'm telling you what, his hordes of hell are not going to be your normal person on the street next to you, okay? Like I said, there are, okay, the rule of war on the unleashing of the attack of the sons of light against the company of the sons of darkness, the army of Satan, against the band of Edom, Moab, the sons of Ammon, and against the army of the sons of the east and the Philistines, and against the bands of the Kittim of Assyria and their allies, the ungodly of the covenant. Now, later in this book, there's something that's called the seven nations of vanity. And if you understood the nation, the word nations, nations start with a C, they start with a patriarch, they go for it. And I'm not picking on people groups. This is something you have to understand. This is not really about people groups as much as it is about people and entities who have aligned themselves with the dark Lord. Okay? And you will know them by their fruit. Now, the sons of Levi, Judah, and Benjamin, the exiles in the desert shall battle against them. All their bands, when the exiled sons of light return from the desert of the peoples to the camp in the desert of Jerusalem. I'm saying you have to understand this. There's just tons of code word here. The two houses are in there. That's what I wanted to show you that. Now, this time, this shall be a time of salvation. See, it is woe to the wicked, but tell the righteous it will be well with them. An age of dominion for all the members of his company, and of everlasting destruction for the company of Satan. The confusion of the sons, this is a kind of funny line if you get this one. The confusion of the sons of Japheth shall be great. It shall be great, and Assyria shall fall unsuccored. Okay, and you have no Assyria. These are just, I can't unpack this, but I want you to see something. The division of the kingdom shall come to an end, and iniquity shall be vanquished, leaving no remnant for the sons of darkness. There shall be no escape. The sons of righteousness shall shine all over the ends of the earth and shall go on shining until all the seasons of darkness are consumed. And at the season appointed by God, his exalted greatness shall shine eternally to the peace, blessing, glory, joy, and long life of all the sons of light. On the day when the kittim fall, there shall be battle and terrible carnage before the God of Israel. Now, I have to say this right here. This is something that is really trips people up. This is not a, okay. This is not like literal war. I'm not talking about World War III being unleashed like this, because see, we don't war against flesh and blood. We war against principalities, powers, and spiritual wickedness. This is sort of a theological or spiritual understanding of the battle that's going on. You know, we are to gird ourselves with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The deep understandings that when we see this come down, that host of, we know who they are. We know who we are. We have the tools to withstand it. This is, light dispels darkness. This is about understanding. This is about the power of words. This is about the power of God unleashed in his encrypted understandings, okay? You have to understand, when you listen to some of these wordage, but there's something, and very important, I have to tell you this, because at that time, the assembly of gods and the hosts of men shall battle. And for those who have ears to hear, hear some of this stuff. Causing great carnage on the day of calamity, the sons of light shall battle with the company of darkness amid the shouts of a mighty multitude and the clamor of gods and men. We are, the Nephilim, the mighty men, there are both sides have their men of renown. We are not alone in this thing. Part of me wants to cry again, because with the depth of this thing that's been hidden, you think God would put us on this little planet with all these hordes of Satan and just leave us with no army surrounding us? The hosts of heaven, these are our, okay, I'm getting some, there's a, I'm going to have to pick up on this next week. You have to read this thing. It's all about the banners and the shields and the formations and how, you know, relentlessly you're going to, we're going to strike down the enemy, because truth revealed. Remember, light will dispel darkness as this understanding, as the veil is lifted. Satan's going to think he's got everybody fooled, but God is just going to, he's just going to pour down such light on his people. It's going to be like, oh my gosh, oh, it's you? Oh, out of here in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our hosts of heaven, or the head of the army at the of the hosts of heaven is Yahweh, is the Lord God Almighty. Okay, so we have, you know, we do have the biggest daddy on the block in this thing. I'm getting these little signals that I'm running out of time. So I just want to go over this again, because see, you have to understand there will be angels among us. He said, many of you have entertained angels unawares. When you really look at the book of Revelation, it is written to the angel of the church. This is one of the revelations that's coming fast and forward. I can't really unpack that to this extent. Here's another little whole paragraph from here. For thou art, O God, in the glory of thy kingdom, and the congregation of thy holy ones is among us for everlasting succor. We will despise kings. We will mock and scorn the mighty. And this is the kings of the earth. And for those who have understanding that we've sort of have been hoodwinked and ruled by these fallen angels, these shepherds, that this is some deep stuff. But anyways, we will mock and scorn the mighty, for our Lord is holy, and the King of glory is with us, together with the holy ones. Valiant warriors of the angelic host are among our numbered men. And the hero of war is with our congregation. The host of his spirits is with our foot soldiers and horsemen. They are as clouds of dew covering the earth, as a shower of rain shedding judgment on all that grows on the earth. He said, we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. I wish I could unpack that word cloud, because cloud is like almost like a really easy encrypted word to understand it, to get right away. When you see like a whole flock of birds out there from a way big distance, it looks like a cloud. And then as it comes closer, you begin to realize that it's really made up of individual parts. And then they get closer and you begin to realize, wow, those are birds. See, when Jesus comes on the clouds, you think he's really coming in clouds? No, he's coming and with his host, his heavenly army is coming. We're not fighting this thing by ourselves, people. We have so much. See, this is why you just got to do this. We have so much to succor us, to encourage us, to strengthen us, to give us hope, and to give us the victory. We win this thing, okay? Because I really believe in the next weeks and months, things are going to change. We're going to wake up one morning, it's a whole new world, okay? That's all I got to say. So you just need to be prepared. You need to get oil, because it's going to happen. I can't give you the oil that's in my brain. That's why the virgins get shut out, the foolish ones, the ones that have been playing Farmville, okay? I can't take my understanding and just give it to you. It doesn't work that way. You've got to get some for yourself. So starting now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, blessing, shalom, in his name, amen.